Job chapter number 1, if you have a Bible this morning. Job chapter number 1, in just a moment, I'll begin reading in verse number 1. One writer said, the book of Job is a form of dramatic poetry. It is known to be the oldest book in all of the Word of God. This man Job was a righteous man. He was a holy man. As a matter of fact, the Bible said in the book of Job chapter number 1 and verse number 1, there was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and that man was perfect and upright, and one that feared God and eschewed evil. The Holy Ghost of God is beginning the whole book by referring to the testimony and the character of Job. This was a man that stood for God. That refers to him being upright. He was perfect. That is his spiritual maturity in Christ. He feared God. He lived a life knowing what God could do and what God would do. The Bible says that he eschewed evil. He hated the very sight or the smell of evil in his life and in the life of his family. Verse number 2, Job said, and there were born unto him 7 sons and 3 daughters. His substance also was 7,000 sheep and 3,000 camels and 500 yoke of oxen and 500 she-asses and a very great household. Watch this statement. So that this man was the greatest of all the men of the East. The Word of God is letting us know about the substance, the physical blessing that God had given Job. Verse number 4, and his sons went and feasted in their houses, everyone his day. I believe it was F.B. Meyer that said this refers to their celebration of their birthday. And sent and called for their 3 sisters to eat and to drink with them. But watch what Job is doing while his sons and his daughters are feasting, while they are celebrating their day. And it was so when the days of their feasting were gone about that Job sent and sanctified them and rose up early in the morning and offered burnt offerings according to the number of them all. Notice this statement, for Job said, it may be he had a concern. He was interested. It may be that my sons, not my daughters, but my sons have sinned and curse God, not on the outside. I believe if they would have came to the house of God, if it would have been around in those days, Job's sons would have came in a suit and a tie. I believe they would have been carrying their Bible. I believe they would have been singing in the choir. Job wasn't concerned with the outside. Watch what Job said about his sons. They have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. So thus did Job continually. Let us understand that Job was a very wealthy man. But isn't it amazing, even though in substance and in blessing he was the greatest man in the East, he had time, or can I say it this way, he made time to pray for his sons and to pray for his children and send up sacrifices to God. That tells me that Job was more concerned about his family than he was his career. He was more concerned about his family than he was a ministry. He was more concerned about his sons than anything else that the world had to offer. I want to say in this day and hour, oh God, help us as mothers and fathers to realize we're raising up a generation that knows not God. I think we ought to do as Job did and get down upon our faces and beg and cry to a holy God for our children. Watch what happened in verse number 6. You know the story. Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord. But notice this statement, and Satan came also among them. And the Lord said unto Satan,
I can imagine as those sons of God was walking around the throne of God trying to get the attention of God. God didn't even look their way, but he did see when Satan approached the throne. So the Lord said unto Satan, "Whence comest thou?" Then Satan answered the Lord and said, "From going to and fro in the earth and from walking up and down it." Satan said, "I've been searching the four corners of the earth. I've been walking to and fro, seeking whom I may devour." That's exactly what he's doing in this day. That's exactly what he's doing in this hour. Can I make this statement? He is not concerned about the drunkards. He has them. He is not concerned about the dope head. He has them. But he is looking for your children, and he is looking for your family, and he is looking in this church, and he is searching the house of the men of God. He's walking to and fro, seeking whom he may devour. He said, "God, I've been searching for somebody I can mess up their life. I've been looking for somebody. I want to destroy their family. I want to destroy the life of their children. I've been walking. I've been searching." But here's an amazing thing. You know the verse in verse number 8. "And the Lord said unto Satan." Satan never mentioned Job. Satan never said anything about Job. As a matter of fact, I don't even know if Satan at this time had Job upon his mind. But look what God did as Satan is in front of the throne of God. "And the Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered?" What a word. "Hast thou..." I hope you have a King James Bible, because if you don't, you ain't going to get my message. "Hast thou considered?" Have you thought about? Have you pondered? Have you put it on your mind? "Hast thou considered my servant, my boy, my son? There ain't nobody like him. Every time I look down upon the earth, he's being faithful, and he's serving me, and he's doing good, and he hates evil. He hates your existence. Hast thou considered my servant, Job?" How many meetings have I been at, and I've already done it myself before, not even knowing what I was doing to myself. But how many times have we been in meetings, and we've heard the preachers, and we've heard the testimonies, and we've heard the missionaries, and we stood up and we bragged on our faith, and we bragged on what we have done, and we bragged on how holy we are because of some little standard or some little conviction that we have on the outside, and we think, "Oh, how holy they are and how wonderful they are." How many times have we heard men of God, so-called, get up and brag about their ministry and all the buildings that they have built and all the things that they have done, and we think to ourselves, "Oh, what faith they must have in God." But isn't it amazing? God wasn't bragging on Job's faith. Here's the message. It is not my faith in God that makes me a great Christian, but it's God's faith that he has in me that says what kind of Christian I truly am. It was God that said, "Hast thou considered my servant Job?" It was God that said, "You can put him in the valley and I'll still trust him. You can put affliction in his life and he'll still serve me." It is not my faith in God that makes me a great Christian, but it's the faith that God has in me that says what kind of Christian I am. Oh, it ought to be easy to praise God in a meeting like this. It ought to be easy to say, "I love God," when all your bills are paid and when you're standing on the mountain high. But what about when you're spiritually flat upon your back and you don't have a dollar in your pocket? Can I say he's still God, and he's still on the throne, and he's still the King of Kings? He's God this morning. It's not my faith that I have in God. How can I not trust a perfect God? How can I not put my faith in a God? He didn't send me Moses. He didn't send me Abraham. But he sent me the very best that heaven had, God's only begotten Son. How can I not have my faith in a God that would bleed and die for me and get up on the third day? It's not my faith makes me a great Christian. But I just wonder this morning, what about God's faith that he has in us? Hast thou considered? Satan, I got one that I can trust. Can I say, number one, quickly, something about the challenge of his faith? The Bible said, then you know the story, you know the verse. Then Satan answered the Lord and said, doth Job fear God for naught? Watch verse number 10. Hast thou, this is an amazing verse, hast not thou made an hedge about him and about his house and about all that he hath on every side? That tells me something. I believe Satan, as he was walking to and fro, he went by the house of Job and he tried to get into this man of God's house, but there was a hedge of protection about Job. There was a hedge of protection around his substance and around his children. I believe Satan tried to find a crack in the door. I believe Satan tried to find a window open, but there was nowhere to enter. It's an amazing thing to me. God has to give Satan permission to touch my life and to touch your life. I'll tell you how big my God is. Yes, Satan is powerful. Yes, Satan is a big creature, but he ain't nothing compared to my God. He has no power without the permission of God. Hast not thou made a hedge? God, I would have already destroyed his life. That's the one I'm after, the one that's faithful. That's the one I'm after, the one that fears you. I would have already messed up his life, but you have put a hedge of protection about him. Look at verse number 10, and thou hast blessed the work of his hands, and his substance is increased in the land. I heard a preacher say one time that Job was a great businessman. You're crazy. Job just loved God, and God began to bless him, and God began to touch him. We don't have nothing if it's not for God. We're nobody if it's not for God. It was God that blessed the work of Job. The challenge of his faith. Verse number 11, but put forth thine hand now and touch all that he had. And he will, here's the challenge, he'll curse thee to thy face. Satan looking up to the face of God on the throne. Take it away, God. The only reason he's serving you is because you blessed him. The only reason he's serving you is because you've given him great substance and you've given him great health in his body. But take it all away, God. I challenge you, take it all away, God, and he will curse thee to thy face. I've got to say this morning, God's been good to me. God's blessed me. God's done more for me than I ever dreamed and I ever deserved. But I wonder if that's why I'm serving God. I wonder if that's why I'm praising God this morning. I wonder if that's why I'm still faith. Take it away, God. He'll curse thee. But look what God said. And verse 12, and the Lord said unto Satan, here's the challenge. Behold, that means pay attention, devil. Take heed to what I'm about to say. Behold, not some of it, but all that he hath, watch this, is in thy power. It's like God took his holy hands out. And here's everything that Job has. Here's his sons. Here's his land. Here's his substance. It's all in my hands, Satan. It has nothing to do with Job. It has everything to do with God. And it's like God presented everything that he had, and he put it with outstretched hands to the hand of Satan. And he said, I'll give you a challenge. Take it away, and he'll still be faithful. Take it away, and he'll still praise me. Take it away, he'll still give me the glory. It's not my faith in God that makes me some great Christian, but I wonder if God has enough faith in me that he would trust me in the valley and in the affliction, the challenge. But can I say, number two, look at the consequences of his faith. The Bible said in verse number 13, everything that happened to Job wasn't because of his sin. every trial that happened to Job, that's what his friend said. That's what his wife almost said. That's what his family said. But it wasn't because of the wrong that he was doing. It wasn't because of some lifestyle that he was living. But the consequences of his faith is because he was living upright. He was fearing God. You said, preacher, I don't know why I'm in the valley this morning. I still read my Bible. I'm sitting in the house of God on a Tuesday morning. I don't understand why God is doing this to me. Can I give you an answer? I don't understand either, but I know this: even in the valley, God's still good, and God still loves you, and God still cares for your soul. This is the consequences of his faith. Verse number 13, and there was a day when his sons and his daughters were eating and drinking wine in their eldest brother's house. We learned when this occasion happened, it was Job that was praying. We learned earlier in the passage when they were at their house feasting, Job was on his face sacrificing to God, saying, oh God, help my boys. God, get their heart. I don't know. I know they talk right now. I know they look right. But God, I'm concerned with their hearts. And Satan waited until Job was back down on his face again, praying for his children. Watch verse 14, and there came a messenger. You know the story, you know the verses unto Job. And said, the oxen were plowing, and the asses feeding beside them, and the Sabaeans fell upon them and took them away. Yea, they have slain the servants with the edge of the sword, and I only am escaped alone to tell thee. Job is still down upon his knees. Job was still just got finished praying and sending up sacrifices. While yet was yet speaking, there came also another and said, not the fire of the devil, but the fire of God is fallen from heaven and hath burned up the sheep and the servants and consumed them, and I only am escaped alone to tell thee. While he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, the Chaldeans made out three bands and fell upon the camels and have carried them away, yea, and slain the servants with the edge of the sword, and I only am alone, escaped alone to tell thee. While he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, Job had been praying. Job had been sacrificing for his sons. Thy sons and thy daughters were eating and drinking wine in their eldest brother's house. And behold, watch this, there came a great wind from the wilderness. The Bible said that Satan is the prince and the power of the air. Satan cannot be everywhere at once. He is not God. Satan got his cronies. Satan got his demons. Satan got his family, his people to take care of the other situation. But Satan headed to the eldest son's house, and a great wind took the four corners. Satan said, I got this one. I got this one. Look what the Bible said. There came a great wind from the wilderness and smote the four corners of the house. Watch this statement. And it fell upon the young men, not the daughters. They're dead, and all him escaped alone to tell thee. Job was praying, oh God, I know my boys talk right now. I know they look right. God, there are just some things in their life. God, I want to know that my boys are going to spend eternity with God, with heaven. I want to know that my boys are going to go with me when they die. God, I know maybe they're fine, but God, I just don't know about their hearts. God, would you do something in their lives? Would you change their lives? God, would you touch my boys one more time? God, I remember when I had my first boy, I thought he'd be a prophet. I thought he'd do something for God, but God, he's not doing that. He's let the riches, he's let the substance get to him. But God, you give me another one. I thought maybe this is the one that would serve you until his dying day, but God, they're just not doing that. Oh God, I want to pray for my sons. Oh God, get a hold of their heart. Job, you lost all your substance. It's all right. I didn't want to lose my servants. I love them, but they can take all I have. I'm just concerned about my boys. Job, Job a great wind? Your sons, Job, they're gone. And every bit of it was the consequences of Job's faith. Just because you're in the valley doesn't mean that God hates you. Just because God may have allowed your loved one to leave a little earlier than we thought they should, it doesn't mean that God doesn't care for you. No, we don't understand the valley. No, we don't understand the storms in life. I don't know why you're suffering today. Oh, but I'm glad we can still trust God and put our faith in God. God's still in control of every situation. It was the consequences of his faith. Number three, and I'm done. Look at the choice of his faith. Bible said in verse 20, then Job arose. He had been praying. He'd been talking to God. And he rent his mantle and shaved his head and fell down upon the ground. Watch this. And he worshiped. Somebody said the first mention of worship is in the book of Genesis with Abraham and Isaac, and that's true according to the canon of the scriptures. But if Job is the oldest book in the Bible, the first time we see in the Word of God that's inspired by the Holy Ghost of God, we see a man that had just lost his substance. We see a man that had just lost his servants. We see a man that had just lost his sons. And he fell down. He didn't say, God, why did you let this happen to me? He didn't get up and put his fist up to God and say, I'll never serve you again. But the Bible said that he fell down and he worshiped. That means this. He said, I'm nothing, God. I'm not worthy, God. Oh, but you're worthy, God. I don't know why all this happened, but you're still God and you're still worthy. I worship you, God. The choice. Verse 21, Job said, naked, this refers to his substance, came I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return thither. You know what he just said to God? I don't care about that. It doesn't matter to me, God. But look what he said about his sons. The Lord gave. The Lord taken away. Blessed. I'll never be able to pray for him again, God. But I still bless your name. I don't know why this happened, God. But I still bless your name. Here's his choice. In all this, Job sinned not, nor charged God. Watch this. One word, foolishly. That means he didn't say, God, this is your fault. God, I blame you. And isn't it amazing? Job had no idea the conversation between his God and Satan. You study your Bible, you know the story better than I do. Satan is heading once again to the throne of God. He is pointed in that direction. I can imagine as the four corners are falling upon the sons of Job, as Job is praying for those sons, I can imagine Satan heading back to the throne of God, thinking, I've got him now. God just thought, I didn't figure the substance would get him, and I wasn't real sure about the servants. Oh, but I've got his sons now. That's the ones that he loves. That's the ones that he's concerned about. He's going to curse God to his face. God just thought that he had somebody that would be faithful through the storms. God just thought that he had somebody that would be faithful to the trials. I got him now. And as Satan is approaching the throne of God, Job receiving the news of his boys, Job falling down upon his face. I'm not going to charge you, God. I'm just going to worship you. God, though I don't understand it, I can't explain it. I still believe you, God, and I still love you, God. I'm going to worship you, God, whatever comes my way. If it wasn't for you, God, I wouldn't have nothing anyhow. If it wasn't for you, God, I wouldn't have a family to pray for. God, you're everything to me. You're all that I need, God. I can imagine God, as soon as Satan is coming his way, I can imagine God saying, hurry up, devil. Come here. look down upon the earth. What's he doing? Satan turning around looking at Job. God smiling. I knew it. I told you I could trust him.
Yeah.
I told you, you can take everything that he has, and he'll still be faithful. Preacher, it's not my faith that I have in God that makes me a great Christian. But what I wonder about in my life and my ministry, what about God's faith in me? Here's the message and I'm done. Can God trust you? Dear Heavenly Father, God, we praise you. And we thank you, God, not just for what you've done, but for who you are, because you're still God. If you've done nothing for us, you're still God. Lord, I don't even want to come close. God, I couldn't take what Job took. But God, in my little valleys, in my midnight hour, God, let me be somebody that you can trust. God, I know there's people in this building that are discouraged, wondering why. I know there's people that are in the valleys of their life, and they don't understand what's happening now. God, would you let them know and encourage them that you still care and you still love them? But Lord, it's in those valleys that we learn who and what kind of Christian we really are. God, help us to be a Christian that you can trust. In Jesus' name I pray. Preacher, you come.